beyond which Bartolomeo Diaz hadn't gone. He didn't know beyond that. Until that, Bartolomeo Diaz had made maps. That's why today you have maps, or a lot of old maps are called Bartolomeo maps. Okay, there was no map. He was wondering how to go. That is when he finds Indian ships, which are at least 10 times the size of his ships. And in the midst of these ships, he comes all the way to the west coast of India, Malabar coast. So he writes that, you know, the Indian ships I found here are so many times bigger. It's all, those details are there. So now, what did this land become? Cape of Good Hope. Because Vasco da Gama, when he reached there, he found hope that he could now go to India. Because unless you turn Cape of Good Hope, you cannot see the Eastern world. So for all these people, if they have to see the Eastern world, they have to cross this bit. Only then they get exposed to this entire area of richness for them. So that is why it became Cape of Good Hope. See how much lies. But what does this tell you? If they say that this place is called Good Hope, so what is that hope representing? Hope of finding India. So look at what it meant, what India meant for them. In 1400s, India meant so much that they were willing to call this, they had their hopes pinned on finding India. In fact, he had been sent that if you don't find India, you cannot come back. So they write in his story and all, you'll find that, you know, he writes because he's very desperate to find India. He cannot go back without finding India. He'll be killed if he goes back without finding India. So India meant so much for the world. Another beautiful thing, you know, you will find in... But how did Europe come to know of all these things from India? See, they took this long route, eastern, through the sea. Before that, how were things going from India? Merchants, yes. But how? Which merchants? Yeah, saman, yes. Spices, cloth and all that. We'll see what all. But Arab merchants, right? So, Arabia, the Arab merchants were the window to India for the West, for Europe. That is why when maths went, when everything went, we have written a series of books which are called Brand Bharat. There are 5 volumes. So one volume deals with all the things that were made and went from here, like metallurgy and lot more things. We will see a few of them. 2, all the knowledge systems that went from here that changed and then came back, took their own form and so on. So which is why when maths went, all the numbers are called Arabic numerals. So because it was the Arabs who took everything from India. So for you know, the Arabians, what is India then? India is a treasure house. India is not a market. India is a supplier. India is very precious to them. India is very important. India was very, very important to the Arab world. Today the Arab world is important to the rest of the world. Why? Petrol, oil. But those days, it was India which was very important to the Arabians and the Western world. So what did the Arabs call India? You know what they did? Whenever they, their girls, daughters. So in what happens in a family, who is the most precious? A son and a daughter. The daughter is usually cherished more, right? Don't you get more love? So the daughter is more cherished. She is more precious. So what did they do? They named their daughters Hind. Hind. Hind means precious for them. So Hind is that which is coming from Hind. But why name somebody called Hind? Why name your daughter Hind? Right? That is because Hind means precious. Hind means. So Hind meant so, they really loved Hind so much that they were naming their daughters Hind. Okay, so in fact, one of the royal ladies is called Al Hind. And Al is like Sri, the way we write Sri and all that, right? Sri so-and-so and all, Srimati and all. So Al Hind, they name their daughters Hind. Look at the beauty in this whole thing. Maths was called Hindsa, that which came from India. So that is about the ships, right? Look at this. They were searching for India. Look at all the names. India, East Indies, West Indies, Red Indians, Indonesia. Everything the world was India-centric. India meant so much to the world that everybody was searching for India. It was like the pot at the end of the rainbow, pot of gold. So he writes, and these were the ships. So they had just these two. We had Gamini, Tari, Jangala, Plavini, Dharini, Begini. Look at the size. Now, tell me. You are saying cotton went, spices went. Why do I need such a big ship for cotton and spice? What do you think went? What else went? Gold, no. Other than Kolar, there has been no gold mine in India. Steel. Steel. And then, look at the word. The word navy. What do we say? Navgat, right? In Indian language, Sanskrit root is Navgat. So, a lot of variations in every language. In Tamil, they say Navai. There will be various variations. Navy, it comes from the same Nav. Root is Nav. In fact, even Noah's Ark, Noah, that also has a root in the word Nav. So much was India's share in world trade, but we'll leave these numbers. We'll go to why did we need such big ships? So which were the big five things? Iron and steel, zinc, cotton, indigo, sugar and spice. Not only spice, sugar and spice. Whole Karnataka belt here, Mandya, everywhere you're growing. Lot of sugar cane, right? It's a sugar belt. India's sugar. India has played a major role in the trade of sugar, in sugar reaching the West. And how the story actually is, sugar is so sweet, but it's got such a bitter story in it, behind it. How it has changed the world demography, the whole global demography and the global composition of the world has changed because of sugar. And I will show you a little bit of that. But first, let's start with iron and steel. So before these people, Vasco da Gama, Columbus and all, we had Marco Polo in 1200s, 1290s. He actually made a journey of the Eastern world by road. So like I said, the Arabs were going by road. He came by the land route and went over, and he sees all the steel and he speaks of it as Hundwani, on the neek. And the Greek have written about the Indian steel. What was the steel called? It was called Urukku. Ukku, uts. So the word uts comes from ukku. Uk, uks. So the British, they made it woods from ukku. Ukku means to smelt, right? So one of the famous Arab ruler, King Saladin, you've heard of him, right? King Saladin. Now what was the speciality of this wood steel from India? Any idea? Non-rusting. So Delhi iron pillar and all is made of non-rusting. That is okay. But fine, today I am going to use it. What does it matter if it won't rust after 100 years? Today when I use it, how do I want my steel to be? Sharp. Extremely sharp. But light to hold. So it was light, but very sharp. And how do you get this idea of this this quality of steel, of Indian steel, wood steel? Now, in England, there was this, have you heard of English king called King Arthur? King Arthur? There was a king, he was called King Arthur. He was one of the famous kings of England. And his sword is supposed to be even more famous. And what was his sword called? Lot of people, you would have seen it, it's used as a brand. Excalibur. You know, there's even a shirt, I think arrow shirt or something, Excalibur and all that. Excalibur was King Arthur's sword. So once King Richard and this King Saladin, they meet. King Saladin meets very, he's in disguise. So this was the Dark Age. What happened in Europe is from about 600 CE. CE means Common Era. And what is before 1 CE, what will you call it? Before Common Era. So BCE. So instead of AD, BC. AD after Christ, from Christ, and BC before Christ, the world has started using Common Era. The year remains the same. 1 AD means 1 CE. And 1 BC is 1 BCE. Because they want to make it very general for the world. And rather than, fix it with Christ and, his date. So 1 CE and BC. So from 700 CE till about 1300, 1400 CE, that is about 700 years, there was a lot of struggle in Europe. It was called Dark Ages. So it was the time when, 700 CE, that was when Islam was coming up. So Islam and Christian, and within Christianity you had Catholic, Protestant, and all this total everything, each one was fighting with the other to impose their religion on the other. So that period, 600, 700 years in Europe, where religion gained supremacy, was called Dark Ages. So it was plunged in darkness, there was nothing happening, no progress, everywhere there was terror. So in this condition, we have King Saladin, he's in disguise, he's an Arab. And he meets King Richard somewhere, they're both discussing about swords. So King Richard says, we have King Arthur's Excalibur, which can break stone. So what does King Saladin do? He says, oh, look at this sword. And he just throws a piece of silk and he, slashes it with his sword. Can you slash flying silk with sword? You can do that only with a wood sword, wood steel sword, because it's so fine and sharp that it can cut through silk. You need tension, right? Only if it is hard, you can cut. If it's something is soft, can you cut it? You can't cut. But this was so sharp that it could cut soft silk which is flying in the air. So that was the popularity of this wood steel. And even in England, when Michael Faraday, he was doing his experiment for the bulb, he wanted good filament. By then, England was already exporting steel to India, the steel that it was making. And it was killing the Indian steel industry because it wanted to export and it wanted to encourage its industry. It had killed all the industry here and it was exporting to India. But Michael Faraday said, I want Indian steel to do my experiment. So this is what I am saying about King Richard and King Saladin, Damascus and Excalibur. And much of the steel, ukku, that's how it gets its name, right? A lot of it was found in the Mysore belt. In fact, that is how the British, they say, there are records in the book you will find how when the British traveler, he goes across and he starts documenting about the metals found in India. He says this is one of the trade which is very popular in this region. Then we come to zinc. What do you call zinc in Kannada? Huh? Sattu, okay. But another name? Old name? Somebody said. Na? Tuttanaga? Mailu Tutta, Tuttanaga? Yeah, Mail Tutta, Tuttanaga, they're all, different variations of those, different compounds of those things. Zinc is called Tuttanaga. Now, this was a big trade secret. What happens with zinc? Nobody knew how to do it. In India, we had a lot of centers where you could do this. In Karnataka especially, you have, you know, in the border, you have Bidar, right? You have Bidri. You have heard of Bidri? Bidri work, right? So these kind of fine crafts, which for which this belt is very popular, and various other parts of India, in Rajasthan also, you have Zawar, which is very, very popular for zinc. Now, why was zinc very special? Nobody else in the world was making zinc. Until 1600s, the world did not know how to make zinc. All the zinc went only from India. It has medicinal values. It is used for various alloys. That is one part. But the challenge was how to get zinc from zinc ore. Zinc is a metal which is very difficult to melt. It has a very high boiling point, somewhere around 900 degree. And very soon after that, it also becomes vapor. It becomes a gas. So how do you catch? It has a very small window within which you should catch it. Otherwise, you cannot catch the zinc metal. So what did our intelligent ancestors do? What happens to vapor? How does it go? In which direction? Upward. So if you just melt zinc and allow the vapor, it will just become vapor and go upward. So what should you do if you want to catch it? You should do it downward. So what did our ancestors do? They did downward distillation. So they put the pot and they put the flame on the top instead of the bottom. So they... image is not coming here. Sorry. Yeah. So boiling point 907, melting point, vaporization 100,000. So they put the flame on top, they put the pot here, put the ore here, and they made one hole over here. So because of the heat, when it starts melting, before it can vaporize, through this hole they would collect the liquid and put it in, and the liquid was, and this pot was placed in a cool chamber. So because of that, the metal would immediately condense. So they didn't allow the vapor to escape at all. Very simple today when we see it. But then the world didn't know about it. And India had kept it a very closely guarded secret. Zawar, Rajasthan, so many millions of tons. Then the Chinese took it from India. So what did they do? Here we have Tuttanaga. So that became Totamu in China. So they made it as Totamu or Tutnag. Then Persians, they called it Tati when it went from China. English also, they still call it Tati. Still you can find Tati for zinc. Zinc is the name given by the Germans. Finally, in Europe, there was a person called William Champion of Bristol who went to China, saw that they were doing this, and in 1740, they started making zinc in Europe. So until then, India was ruling the world with zinc. Zinc is needed in brass. Tin and zinc make brass. Tin and copper make bronze. And what do you need bronze for? To make your vessels. Your cooking vessels are made from this. So like that, there are so many... Look at this specialty. How they made this swords. They had to bring in lot of carbon. It's a high carbon steel. So how do they get the carbon in it? So they had a lot of various techniques, and one of the techniques was they took this plantain leaf, and the hot rod would be kept here and wrapped. So a lot of the natural compounds which are present would then get absorbed by the steel. And the speciality is you could see them like patterns of ant, like this. So the wavy, wavy pattern made by ant. And what is wavy, wavy called in Arab world? In Arabic world, what is the Arabic word for waves? Damas. D Damas. Everybody now wears D Damas designs, right? For jewelry. D Damas. So from that, what do you also have? Which is the place? Damascus. From there you got Damascus. So from India, all this went. It became popular in Damascus. So you started getting Damascus swords after that. So which is why Europe started calling it Damascus swords. And Damascus swords became popular in the world. But those swords were from India's wood steel. So we've seen zinc, iron, which